This is Semantic Web Technologies, lecture number 3, Basic Architecture of the Semantic Web, part 2. We continue with the question, how can we query RDF or RDFS databases, knowledge bases, with the help of the Sparkle query language? In the last part of the lecture, we have learned the basics about Sparkle and how an RDF graph is traversed with the help of this Sparkle query language, which is a graph query language and which forms graph patterns that will be matched against the RDF graph. And we will continue with some more complex examples. So, first we will learn something more, because up to now we simply have filtered an RDF graph with the help of these graph patterns. But what we can't do by now, we cannot put some conditions to these graph patterns. We had to explicitly formulate triples that express things that can be matched and selected from the graph. But in addition, we can specify constraints on the results that we want to have selected, and these constraints can be given in Sparkle with the help of the filter keyword. So, take this as an example. We have a Sparkle knowledge base consisting of the blue box we have seen here, we see here. So we have three prefixes, and then we have here the prefix DC, which stands for Dublin Core, which is for identifying or characterizing bibliographies. Then we have a default prefix, and we have another namespace prefix. And there we have a book, and this book has a title from the DC namespace, which is, for example, Sparkle Tutorial, and the book has a specific price, and the price is 42, whatever. And we have a second book, which has the title The Semantic Web, and the price is 23. So, now, for example, if I want to select from this database only the books that cost less than, let's say, 30.5, I do this via the following filter expression. So here again, I have the Sparkle with the DC and the NS namespace, and what I want to select is the title and the price of a book. And I select this from this book database, knowledge base, and there I say the following graph pattern. I have the variable X to select the book, and I will select only the triples that have here the property price and as price, and I will also select the price. But I will only take these triples where the following filter condition is satisfied, which is the price must be less than 30.5. And of course, again, for these books that fulfill this filter condition, I want to select the titles. And the result will be, of course, then here, simply the second book, because the price is less than 30.5, it's only 23, and the other one that costs 42 will not be selected. So you have filter conditions. And again, for these filter conditions, you have several operators, as you can see, that you can use. You have some binary operators, you also have some unary operators. For example, you have here the exclamation mark, which says no, or which defines a negation. So some operator will be negated. You have a Boolean operator that has of DB of type Boolean, of course, and then with this exclamation mark, it will be negated. On the other hand, you have a plus and a minus, which can be applied to some numeric value, and where for that will be interpreted as positive or as negative sign. On the other end, you can ask if a variable is bound, and the result will be a Boolean. Either it is bound, so it means it has a value, then the result is true, or it has not a value up to now, then the result will be zero or false. Then you can ask if an RDF term A is a URI or not. So the result will again be Boolean true or false. Then you can ask if a specific RDF term is a blank node, or if an RDF term is a literal, or if an RDF term is a string, for example. And again, you can also ask for a language tag. So which language does a specific string or a specific literal have? And you can ask for a data type. So which data type has a specific given literal, and the data byte type, for example, will be given back as the URL of the according data type. So these are the unary operators that can be used in the filter expression. Then there are some more logical connectives. For example, we have here the AND and the OR for Boolean values. We have comparison operators. You already have seen one of the comparison operators, which was the less than, and you also have the equal, not equal, less, greater, and less or equal, and later greater or equal for numeric values. Also for data types like date, time, string, and Boolean. Then you have comparison operators for other data types, the equal operator and the not equal operator for data types that are not included in the list you have here, so non-numerical operators. And you have some arithmetic operators like the plus, the minus, the multiplication, or the division for numeric data types. And in addition, what is quite nice, you can use so-called regular expressions. For that, you should refer to what we do in the lab course and in the exercises. There we will put up also filter expressions that are based on regular expressions. Or you can compare two terms with a same term operator, and you can compare whether two languages of two given literals do really match. So these are the Sparkle operators that can be used. And when you use filter expressions and you combine then RDF or filter expressions within Sparkle, you should take into cooperation that into consideration that Sparkle does not necessarily is not necessarily based on a binary logic, but in fact it's based on a ternary logic. So it's based on a three-value logic because each part that is connected via or AND might be either true or false, or there might be an error as the result. So error is treated as a special, as a third return value that has to be taken into consideration when it's combined with the or the AND operator. So in the end, you will come up with a value table like this one. So when true, for example, is combined with an error, if you connect it via AND, then of course it will be the error. If you connect it via OR, then it will be true. So again, if you connect false with an error, then in the case of OR, it will be an error, and in the case of AND, it will be false. So this is a binary or a ternary pattern for expressions in Sparkle that will be combined via these connectives OR AND. Okay, let's take a look at some more examples. Here we have an example, for example, a small RDF knowledge base where you have two prefixes given, the FOV prefix and the RDF prefix, and you have some facts according to two persons within this knowledge base. So, for example, here you have some more facts about Alice. You have here two mailboxes defined for Alice, for example, and for Bob, you only have the name. And what you do now is you want to select information from this knowledge base, and you want to select also the name of the mailboxes of each person. But what to do with persons that don't have a mailbox information? Usually, if you use your graph patterns, then you would have no chance in one single graph pattern to select both Alice and Bob when you want to combine all information. So either you would select Alice and Bob together without the mailbox information, or you would select only Alice, who has the mailbox information. And therefore, Sparkle provides some interesting keyword. It's the optional keyword, and the optional keyword provides the means to express some patterns that, whenever they are available, will also be processed via that following graph pattern. In the case this pattern or this keyword and triple pattern is not available, then it will be not be processed, but only the first expression before that will be processed and will be part of the answer. So with this optional parameter, you can put there optional matches or optional restrictions onto the graph pattern match that has been performed against the knowledge base. And therefore, you can have with one single query expression also all persons of the database, including the mailboxes, whenever they are available. So this is the meaning of this optional keyword. Okay. But Sparkle also provides even more. We know now from graph patterns that we can combine different graph patterns with somehow a logical AND, so that both conditions must be fulfilled in the same way. What about an OR connection? Up to now, we don't have an OR connection. And in Sparkle, whenever you want to combine some patterns via an OR expression, then you have to use here the keyword union. You see it here. So for example, we have here again a knowledge base with two prefixes, DC 1.0 and DC 1.1, which refers to two different Dublin Core vocabularies. And there we have some books in that knowledge base, and you have the title of the book and the creator of a book. And for example, you have here a title according to DC 1.0 standard, and here a title that comes from the DC 1.1 standard. The problem is, if you want to have all titles of all books from that database with a single graph expression, that's not possible. Therefore, you have to combine in your answer these from these two vocabularies via an OR condition. You want either all books where the title comes from the namespace 1.0 or the namespace comes, the title comes from the namespace 1.1. And to combine these two graph patterns in one statement, you see it here, how it's done. You have here the where clause, and then you have two different graph patterns. One is based on the property from DC 1.0. The other one is based on the graph patterns from DC 1.1. And they are combined via the union keyword. So here you have to take into account that each graph pattern, and this can be more than one single graph pattern here, that will be can be combined via union, they must be, each single one stand within these curly braces. So that's the definition. And then you can combine these two, and then all patterns will be selected that comply to this graph pattern or to the other graph pattern. So it's a union, set-based union. Okay, so that's quite nice. Another interesting feature that we also consider is the negation. So somehow we must find something that is comparable to the SQL not exist. Sometimes you want to have information from the knowledge base or from the database where some specific pattern, for example, does not exist or one variable will not be filled or cannot be found. And this you can do in the following way. Consider the following database. You have, we have again here three prefixes, the FOV prefix, the DC prefix, and the XML schema prefix. Then we have here Alice, and we have a blank node A that has a FOV given name Alice, and we have here Bob, a blank node B with a FOV given name Bob, and we have here a DC date given for Bob, and we have here a date time literal. So what we want to do now is we ask the question, just give me all persons, but only those that do not have provided a date. So we want to have all without the date. So we only want to have in the answer Alice. So how to restrict that? And this you can do, for example, with the bound condition. And with this bound condition, you can ask, you only want to have these answers from or these triple patterns from the RDF graph where the variable date is not bound, so where the variable date is not set. And what you here select is everything connected with FOV given name, and here you have the name, and then optional, you have also the DC date for the same person or the same subject you select, but you say, okay, you look for a triple that has a DC date and where date is not set, so where this triple does not fulfill. Therefore, the filter and where date is not bound, where the variable date is not filled. And then here only the first term, the first triple Alice will be returned. So here you have the possibility to formulate some negation. And then you have the possibility to select all persons that don't have this specific property that you define here. On the other hand, you can also select, of course, only Bob if you're referring to only those variables that are really filled or that are really bound. But you can do this in a much easier way. We will see that in the exercises. Okay. We have learned quite much about Sparkle. Just one thing in the end I want to tell you. We haven't just taken a look at the so-called from clause. So what we can do is we can select Sparkle, or we can select graph patterns from more than only one graph. And therefore, we have to distinguish in RDF between the first or more default graphs, where all patterns that we formulate will be asked for. And then we can also, in the same Sparkle query, refer to other graphs. And these other graphs, zero or more, are so-called RDF named graphs. So we have named graphs that can be explicitly addressed within a query. And we have default graphs that will be addressed whenever no named graph is addressed in that way. Therefore, you have the graph keyword where you specify all the graphs you are referring to. And then this graph will be asked with this graph pattern that comes after it. We just have to look at an example that it's more clear. So for example, let's take this very, very complex Sparkle query. What you see here is you have several from statements. All from statements were not from named stands. So it's here from HPIG1 and HPIG4. These form the so-called default graph. So each single graph pattern that is not bound to a specified graph, there the default graph holds, and the question or the query will be carried out against the default graph. Then you have here three so-called named graphs. They are made known via from named, and then HPIG1, HPIG2, and HPIG3. So here you should not be confused, because G1 is here once and here once. So G1 in general is here in the default graph, but nevertheless it can also be specified as some special named graph for a specific part that is then later on, that later on occurs in the where clause. And then you have the where clause. Everything in the where clause where not a specific graph pattern is specified, that will be checked against the default graph. And everything that is identified via the graph keyword, so here, for example, graph HPIG3, which is here a named graph, there this query will be queried against here graph HPIG3. And the others, for example, here, where I have a variable G, and this variable can, it depends from the previous part of the query, so this variable might refer to one of the named graphs we have here. So this would be a rather complex query with different graphs. We can make this more specific, for example, with this example. So the upper one is the default graph with two triples in it. And in these two triples, we have here Bob Hacker and Alice Hacker. And these they are characterized by two files that are here two URIs. And here at the one URI, we have a named graph. And there is also a fourth triple in it. It has a fourth name Bob and the name of a mailbox. And here have the fourth name Alice and the name of the mailbox Alice. And here it's the name of the named graph 2 and named graph 1. And just consider here in the default graph, we again are referring to the names of the named graphs because they are here part of the triples. And what I want to show you in the next example is, for example, how I can also use this graph keyword with a variable where that I do fill from the content of another triple. So let's take a look at this example. I have here again two prefixes. Then I select simply here a graph, a mailbox, and who belongs to the mailbox. And I say my default graph is this default graph I had before. We can shortly take a look at the default graph here. Again, remember we have here the name of some other graph, and the publisher of that other graph is here a literal, and here again, one for Bob, one for Alice. Then I have two named graphs, which is one, the first graph for Alice, and the second graph here for Bob. And then comes my where clause, and here I'm asking first the default graph for the name of the graph and the publisher and the name of the publisher. And then I say, okay, I have here the name of the graph, and this graph will be the next graph I'm referring to. And in this graph, I want to ask for X, which is the mailbox, and mbox, which is then the name of the mailbox. So you see here, what I want to show you is that a named graph can also be a variable. The variable then will be computed from the evaluation of the triples before, from the default graph. And then in the execution, this variable will be substituted by a value that has been computed when evaluating here a graph statement or a triple pattern from the default graph. Okay, that's enough examples for this section of the lecture. In the next lecture, we will have more examples and we'll learn even more about Sparkle.